Once, long ago, some human looked up at the starry skies and was the first to wonder if they might be the realms of the gods or home to other worlds like ours. But some think that maybe they instead looked up in surprise at those skies to see a visitor from those places descending and preparing to change humanity forever. In the last few centuries, the fields of archaeology and paleontology have opened our eyes to the ancient wonders hidden from us by the sands of time. Even before then, we beheld places like the pyramids or Stonehenge, and wondered about the people who built them and why they built them. These megalithic structures are impressive even today, and even more so for being produced by peoples who lacked modern technology. It begs the question of why such extraordinary efforts were made, and also the question of if we got help doing it from some older civilization, residents or visitors from far away that have since vanished from our world. Our history is full of stories of visitors coming to teach us or uplift us, making us or making us more than simple animals, or seeing that intelligence emerging and helping to nurture it along, sometimes for benevolent reasons, sometimes for selfish ones, often for unknown or ambiguous ones, but uplifting us from our primitive state and putting our feet on the path forward to civilization, technology, and the stars themselves. It's an intriguing and compelling concept, and comes in a lot of possible forms, much as uplifting comes in many types: biological, cultural, ecological, neurological, technological, and even non-Darwinian or post-biological options. We'll dip into those more in a moment, but someone uplifting primitive humans might have been showing them fire or bronze working, which would be technological uplifting, or flat-out modifying their brains to be smarter, neurological uplifting, or altering their wider physiology, culture, ecology, or any combination thereof. And we want to discuss this today, along with any suggested evidence or lines of reasoning that would work for or against the notion. For this end, we'll be covering everything from ancient astronaut theories to concepts like directed panspermia, and obviously a lot of these are typically classified as conspiracy theories or pseudoscience. I won't pretend I don't generally agree with that sentiment, and am very skeptical of aliens being involved with our history. Nonetheless, we will try to treat these ideas respectfully and detail them properly, both in their strengths and weaknesses. I will also note that the universe is a really strange place, and we often find things in nature that I, at least, would have assumed were utterly absurd or made up, but were real. So get your drink, snack, and tinfoil hat, hit those like and subscribe buttons, and let's get started. We should start by noting that evidence is pretty hard to get for what happened in the past, especially if it was something done only once or a handful of times. We can find tons of broken pottery because our ancestors made tons of it, and tended to use it near their homes, and often incorporated broken bits into those homes. So even if we only find 1 million old clay pots, we get a pretty decent inventory. And archaeologists and paleontologists, especially modern ones, can determine an awful lot from those bits and pieces, and the context of the place they found them, and other things they found with them, or at other sites. Alternatively, if someone came down and tinkered with our actual brains 100,000 years ago or more, we would only have our fossilized skulls to show the difference, which might not tell you much about a changed brain architecture, that brain being completely gone. Indeed, we often have made serious mistakes about intelligence and thinking ability based off skull shape and size, even discounting earlier pseudoscientific efforts like phrenology. So we have to be very careful assuming much about early humans strictly from their skulls. And the same for non-humans, be it hominids or more ancient critters like dinosaurs. Skull size is not that critical an indicator of brain architecture, and honestly, we don't have a lot of skulls from human ancestors dating to when we think we discovered fire or were taught it. So too, it is worth remembering that someone does the discovering and teaches it to everybody else. So you could easily have someone with a mutant or uplifted brain smart enough to figure that out, that taught it to packmates who were less clever, but smart enough to understand it. Then they die and we never find their skull, and maybe they didn't have any kids either, or ones who inherited that trait. And odds are pretty good that whoever first discovered something is quite an outlier in some fashion. And for that matter, mutants with better brains are hardly guaranteed to breed that trait. So you might get some various traits for higher intelligence popping up a dozen times in a dozen different fashions before one of them actually stuck. Same, it's quite likely someone invented writing and never convinced anyone else of its value and just used it as a way of keeping a personal record. Or that someone figured out how to melt some copper out of some rocks but never had occasion to find such a rock again. Or just thought the rivulets of metal were interesting and didn't do anything else with them 30 or 40,000 years before anyone else really got into metalworking enough to leave examples behind. All archaeological and paleoontological timelines are as mercurial as that molten metal. Sometimes we can lock stuff down very tight into a clear shape, but a lot of times it's shifty around and hard to establish. And sometimes what seems certain or crystal clear turned out to be dead wrong, too. That said, a lot of technological and cultural progress is a gradual group activity, not just one clever outlier doing it all. Even Da Vinci and Einstein didn't exist in isolation or a vacuum, although ironically both are often suggested to have been aliens themselves. Frequently for inventions, things we might look at as a single technology today are often a whole series of processes or individual technologies that give us a rather definitive time frame of when something was invented. Agriculture is the best example because grains naturally select for seeds that had a tough rachis, making them more difficult to break off of the stem. This process can be tracked to show a field transitioning from wild grasses to domesticated grains, a process that takes around 1,000 years, sometimes longer. A lot of our foods took long times to be made decently edible, digestible, or domesticated. Not all innovative failures are hidden by time either. Sometimes we can pinpoint where something like the focused harvesting of wild grasses took place and then failed. And this by its very nature has to be a gradual process. It's not the same as inventing all the steps involved in a technology like copper smelting. We know at some point humans got much smarter. It's decently well indicated this took multiple steps over long periods too. So we infer from this that the progress was that slow, spiky pattern we associate to evolution. Gradual big changes or quick minor but immense game changer types. And that latter is exactly what someone tinkering with some critter's genetics might look like. There's also the real issue that just because we document 20 changes of note does not mean one of them wasn't artificial just because the other 19 were. So for our basic question today of if humans were uplifted, we need to acknowledge from the outset that we cannot give that a hard no and likely will never be able to. We could find a whole empty galaxy without any other signs of life, let alone intelligence, and still could not say nobody had tinkered with us, since there's a lot of options beyond our galaxy, like us being someone's lab experiment, the entire universe being their construct. However, while you can't really disprove a negative, especially one where there is plausible motive, means, and opportunity, we do need to be mindful that our fossil record of hominids is pretty good and doesn't seem to show any sudden wild leaps. Nor do we necessarily have to disprove something, merely gesture to better theories if we've got them. Science is rarely about total certainty. So this mostly gradual fossil record would push back heavily against any one-time examples of physiological uplifting at least, because our basic form seems to shift gradually. And as we'll discuss in a bit, directed evolution options can be long-term, but mostly do not need to be, and thus would seem a lot of effort where unnecessary, thus probably not what happened. Regrettably, just because we often only have a very partial skeleton of one human from any given millennia and continent, this isn't always the most swaying argument for people, as it's a very complex process of modeling and correlation to fit in our available fossil record, and we also have a history of science news articles overhyping any new find, so that to the casual reader, they think whole new types of mysterious humans are being excavated every year. This is hardly unique to archaeology or paleontology. It happens in every science these days, but they are our focus for today, and I think it has contributed to a lot of the doubt or skepticism folks often have toward challenges to ancient astronaut or alien theories. The final issue we need to consider is what we just mentioned, that any action by an intelligence generally involves having a motive, means, and opportunity for that action. We know the means either already exist, or very likely can be accomplished with modern or near-future science for all the various types of uplifting, so that just leaves motive and opportunity. There's obviously lots of motives for uplifting, and we don't really need to discuss them here, as we covered much of that in our prior video on the ethics of uplifting, so that just leaves opportunity. For my part, this is one of the biggest weaknesses of the hypothesis, because as channel regulars know, I don't think any aliens have had the opportunity to tinker with us, because I don't think it's likely any exist near us. If they did, and can travel here, that's obviously an opportunity. But I would just note they also had motive, means, and opportunity to colonize this planet for themselves and every other planet near us. And it also probably means that they had the capability of simply turning their home and any surrounding solar systems into Dyson swarms or some other more effective means of habitation as well. So if we grant them the existence of the opportunity to come here to tinker with us, we would need to show how they had that motive and opportunity specifically to do that, but lacked one or both of those in regard to any alternative, most of which seem much better. Of course, of the many types of uplifting we've previously covered on this channel, one form which maybe resolves both the need for motive and opportunity is cultural uplifting. As we know from our own history here on Earth, there is certainly motivation to do this, and even with the best of intentions, which we know was often not the case in our own history, cultural uplifting can often be anything but uplifting for those folks receiving it. Whether or not it is possible to do this in some genuinely ethical fashion is hard to say, and to discuss too, it's understandably a touchy topic, but we can certainly imagine it being done to us by outsiders, and it's also hard to imagine how you could do any technological uplifting without it being likely to result in cultural uplifting simply because the technology is going to be associated with the bearer. But cultural uplifting would explain why a civilization might choose to uplift humans instead of any alternative for interstellar travel or colonization. It really only works though if nobody came here before humans existed, which limits us to just the most recent million years, less than 1% of 1% of the time our universe has been around. Needless to say, cultural uplifting can put you on some very thin ice, even assuming you are acting pretty ethically in the process, which again was often not the case in our own history. The same is true of technological uplifting, or any of the others. It's also worth noting that the definition of uplifting can be debated as well. For example, ecological uplifting might include wiping out some local predator that ate early hominids, so they had some breathing room to do more than barely survive. Another possibility would be relocating a local plant that was very good for making early shelter, baskets, or clothing, if we extend this to environmental uplifting. One could even argue striking Earth with a metal-rich meteoroid near areas of human habitation could be considered uplifting, and many a fabled sword or object was made from meteoric iron, usually sent by heavenly entities. Giving a dolphin hands so it can use tools, basically making it a mutant freak to its family and friends, is physiological uplifting and not necessarily doing it any favors. We could also give it cybernetic or other non-heritable brain or physiological augmentations, or non-Darwinian traits like a biologically grown propeller, something that's never ever going to evolve naturally but can be grown and coded into DNA. These are the main types of uplifting, but it is worth noting that we wouldn't tend to expect anyone to only be doing a single type, that they will generally be package deals even if you only meant to do just one of them, since even just a small tweak to something's physiology or technology is likely to alter their culture and their ecology around them. But you might be doing this from the very outset, and that's where directed panspermia comes in. Our fossil record is hardly complete, and there's lots of places, especially in pre-human times, where some fairly heavy-handed physiological or ecological tinkering could have occurred, and us just be ignorant of it just because the record isn't super detailed. Nonetheless, it is pretty detailed, and doesn't show any obvious gaps, but some suggest that tinkering might have been very early on, and even include the initial introduction of life itself. The idea that life on Earth might not have originated on Earth is called panspermia, and it is a completely mundane, if unearthly, scientific theory in and of itself. We don't know where life began, and deep-sea thermal ocean vents are the current lead candidate, but tidal pools and drainage basin lakes both remain pretty popular. And back in the day, tidal pools were the lead contender, and panspermia was second. I'd say it's more like fourth place now. The usual candidate is comets, which have all the right nutrients in them, and good surface conditions for the origin of life in many ways, and we do believe they are what we got our oceans from, after the apocalyptic incident that involved proto-Earth being struck by a dwarf planet and tearing our planetary crust off, from which the moon later formed, and which probably wouldn't have left any water or nitrogen gas lying around. If life did originate on such comets and rain down here, it could then have an environment that allowed much more robust and diverse ecologies to evolve from it. But comets could also potentially have rained down on Mars or Europa, or spread to other solar systems, or spread life from another solar system to here, as there are some simple organisms that could survive being jettisoned into space by an asteroid impact or volcanic explosion, and then survive tucked into some rock or ice ball in the otherwise harsh, radiation-soaked vacuum of space. Again, panspermia itself is considered an implausible, but perfectly respectable theory about the origin of life. Directed panspermia, though, is where we assume someone colonized the galaxy by using this process, either seeding comets or just sending out probes to land and plant basic life somewhere. This itself would simply be artificial panspermia, and has been considered as an alternative way to bring life to a galaxy if we could never make interstellar space colonization work out. See our recent Interstellar Colonization Compendium for why we probably can make that work, but until we've done it, it is hard to say for sure it can be done. The directed part is where we assume that those basic elements they introduced had more complex targets in mind, so that initial amoeba was set up to be able to produce humans or humanoids down the line. And this is canon in Star Trek from the episode The Chase for the reasons why humans, Vulcans, Romulans, Klingons, Ferengi, and so on are all humanoid. In practice, it's because special effects and makeup budgets limit your alien options. Lots of ancient aliens in Star Trek, and in this case, we have an ancient precursor race that found the galaxy empty and placed basic life everywhere, hoping to evolve it to people one day, and encoded a video on our DNA, too. It is utter nonsense, though I quite liked that episode. But DNA can hold a ton of data, and we don't have any early DNA, so for all we know, they might have had very long and instructive blueprints to help push life to the bipedal humanoid form, but it seems very unlikely. You could do some directing, but not much. And I only don't rule it out because it's absolutely inside the realms of technology to leave things in place to shove evolution down a given path of your choosing. It just seems like directed panspermia would be the unlikely version compared to other directed evolution options, like leaving a machine monitor in place that prodded things occasionally or genetically modified organisms occasionally. If it's grabbing and tweaking organisms here and there on a millennial timeline, you are going to get a seemingly mundane fossil record, because that interference itself is mundane because it happened constantly. It just wasn't natural, but you can't tell. My main objection here is that they could have done this with that same technology so much faster. Terraforming is a slow process, but not that slow. Tens of thousands or millions of years, not billions. And I don't see anyone waiting around that long for results just because they wanted to be minimalist in their involvement to see what random evolution produced. I don't see it being ethically much different to drop proto-life on a dead world compared to steering the evolution through machine monitors for a few billion years instead. Though again, trying to guess what aliens find ethically okay or not, where not strictly logical or utilitarian, is basically wild guessing. And even where logical or utilitarian is still highly speculative and iffy. We already dipped into many of the ethical challenges of uplifting in our episode earlier this year, and we spent more time on each of the various types of uplifting there in terms of explanations and examples. But I felt we needed a refresher today so that we're not just thinking of some alien or higher dimensional entity showing up to give us fire or metal or opposable thumbs and bigger brains. And again, this does not have to be outsiders. It could be some earlier civilization that developed here on Earth, and we are basically mutant descendants of their pets or their surviving lab rats. As you might guess, I'm pretty skeptical of this too, but we would have a hard time finding evidence of their civilization even if they hadn't done anything to intentionally mask its prior presence, something we explored more in our episode on the Silurian hypothesis. So what are some of the better known suggested examples of this sort of interference or uplifting? Probably the best known is the idea that aliens helped us build the pyramids, and generally focuses on the idea that the precision and scale of the pyramids, particularly the Great Pyramid of Giza, are beyond the capabilities of the ancient Egyptians. They point to the alignment with cardinal points or the night sky, the precision of the stone cutting, and the sheer size of the stones used. Many of those stones weigh as much as an entire large modern house, foundation and all, so it is entirely understandable that folks find moving them so impressive to then question if they could have done it on their own. Stonehenge and the Great Pyramids are not the only examples of our ancestors moving giant rocks around before they had good written records to leave detailed notes about how they did it. It was also done on different continents, including those only reachable in that era by ocean-going vessels. So the similarity of some African or Asian pyramids or ziggurats to examples in Mesoamerica is also felt to imply some outside assistance or inspiration. I'm not sure if aliens were seriously suggested as a solution for this mystery prior to 1968 when Eric Van Daniken wrote Chariot of the Gods, and I can't say I lend the work much credence. However, it did inspire a lot of my favorite science fiction, particularly the Stargate franchise, so I won't throw stones at it. That having been said, when it comes to moving stones, the problem has never been that we didn't know the ways in which such quarried stones could be moved with low technological solutions. We just didn't know which specific method they used, or even if it might be one we hadn't thought of. Furthermore, it probably wouldn't have been the same method at every spot. Last I checked, the consensus was that those big stones in Egypt were moved by using wet sand in front of them as a lubricant. But you can find plenty of articles discussing the merits and weaknesses of each of the suggested methods, and even videos of experimental archaeologists attempting to replicate the techniques today. Personally, I tend to be just as fascinated by watching modern folks reconstruct it, as I think it tends to reveal a lot about a civilization that has the general prosperity, time, and energy to dedicate folks and resources to developing the methods to build these megaliths. I also think it says a lot about our civilization having the same room to dedicate researchers to rediscovering these techniques, including all of the backbreaking labor. Amusingly, this latter point could actually be a good argument in favor of alien interference. Because while it would seem like an advanced alien civilization visiting here could easily have just put the blocks there themselves using far more advanced technology, I could imagine visitors also using humans as a testing ground for figuring out their own species' past, or feeling they'd be cheating us of our version of that past and growth to do it all the easy way. Plus, they may be rather post-biological and thus super strong, or just happen to have really good treatment options for pulled back muscles, and thus don't really mind back-breaking labor. Anyway, humans are incredible innovators, so if aliens did plant the seeds of some limited technologies, then they would be able to test a lot of different techniques at once. Either way you cut it, it is truly impressive what our ancestors could do with so little technology, a lot of determination, and, of course, a virtually unlimited supply of expendable labor. Incidentally, I am aware that current evidence shows the pyramids were not built with slave labor, but instead used workers who were paid. But so were the coal miners in West Virginia who were being paid in company script. It was still an autocracy ruled by a god king, so even the most free members of that society had little self-determination. This does raise another point. To command that level of control, to be seen as a god king, while not automatically implying the recipient was particularly impressive or clever, is what we would expect from some entity that was in command of vast alien technologies or anything they could casually display and reasonably expect tons of technologically primitive peoples to drop down on their knees in awe of. And we can hardly say we have no evidence of folks like that, since virtually every early historic figure who we still have some record of either is described that way, or is noted for their interactions with someone described that way. Such narratives seem to exist everywhere, and often fit a Prometheus style, where some titan, demigod, or angelic being came down from on high and gifted us technology or brains. Presumably, in early history and prehistory, where very little documentation was going on, you had to be fairly noteworthy to even get a mention, and the sands of time tend to erase most of those mentions, so that only the really impressive and probably mythological or quasi-historical figures tend to remain, often growing in impressiveness with each new retelling. Unless they weren't, because they actually were godlike. And the problem is we can't really disprove that either. And again, we're not required to disprove it, but then nobody is required to disbelieve it if we can't either. Even if 9 out of 10 of these mythological folks were regular people who grew with each retelling, that last one might have been an alien, walking around in power armor or full of cybernetic enhancements. That we can see a clear tendency among humans to create massive, bigger-than-life mythological figures doesn't really rebut this either, since any alien might notice the habit and cheerfully rely on this tendency to cover over their participation in events. And they obviously have a motive. I mean, if I could jump back in time to the ancient era with a backpack full of modern tech and a brain stuffed full of science and engineering, I would absolutely start showing them how it all worked, once I figured out their language anyway. I have never liked the reasoning of the Star Trek Prime Directive of non-interference with primitive cultures. My current job is a direct reflection of how driven I tend to be to teach science, and I understand the butterfly effect and chaos theory well enough to know that my original timeline was aborted the instant I arrived there. I would feel a moral obligation to teach them what I knew to help them fight off disease and starvation and general misery. And that's likely not to be limited to purely scientific and technical assistance. I honestly can't see any reason why I shouldn't suggest they might find the rule of law and human rights and democracy good things to adopt. And while I'm dubious about the ethics, if they already have some monarch or autocrat ruling them, it's hard to argue that someone else claiming that role, who also brought real blessings of technology, would be objectively wrong to do so. We, or some alien, might find it unethical to let folks view us as a god, but others might not. Amusingly, there is also a Star Trek episode on this exact scenario. But especially after you die and a generation or two passes, you aren't really in a position to object even if you had in the first place, and mythology then simply runs its course. In fact, the reason this episode doesn't mention aliens in the title is that they aren't the only source of possible uplifting. I hold time travel to be almost certainly impossible for exactly the same reasons I hold faster-than-light travel to almost certainly be impossible too. Generally, the ability to do one implies the ability to do the other. See our FTL series for an explanation of why. But if you can't get here by FTL, it seems way less likely someone made a chronological detour to visit for a bit and then left without a trace. Or a definitive trace anyway. They obviously did leave a trace if they helped build our megaliths, early civilization, or tinkered with our brains and genetics. Assuming FTL and time travel are equally possible, and assuming alternate timelines branch off rather than cause acausal or retrocausal paradoxes, then I would actually rate the time traveler option more plausible. One person, or a small group, jumps back and influences this new timeline, and either dies off or returns to their home when. This might even be viewed as an acceptable option for vacation, as there would presumably be a near infinite number of timelines or multiverses you could do this to without disrupting your future and leaving behind another timeline where you hadn't interfered either. In a paradoxical time travel scenario, we could imagine a civilization that took so long to develop originally on Earth that we were almost out of time when it finally got there. Maybe a thousand or a million or even a billion years later than now. We ran out of something, or the sun burned us, or a catastrophic asteroid or supernova hit us, that brought about the inevitable ruin of humanity, but not before some intrepid time travelers leapt back in time to bring about the dawn of technology or intelligent humans sooner than before and early enough to save us from the apocalypse. Amusingly, I originally had Save Us from Doomsday there, but paused for a break before segueing the topic and watched the last episode of Season 1 of X-Men 97. I'm writing this back in May of 2024, before heading out to the ISDC in LA, incidentally, where I'm slated to do a panel and chat with Larry Niven, one of my favorite sci-fi writers, and one who is well known for having some ancient astronauts in his own known space setting, particularly the novel Protector and the Ringworld novels. I am a big fan of the X-Men animated cartoon from the 90s, and it's what got me into comic books, so it's nice seeing a lot of those storylines that hit the comic books in the 90s making it into the restart of that show. That episode ended with a little Easter egg of them introducing the villain Apocalypse back into the plot, and his own background dates to him fighting with the time traveler Kang the Conqueror in ancient Egypt, who was acting as a pharaoh. And I won't spoil the story, but there's a lot of back-in-time tinkering and technological and biological uplifting in those events. Given its popularity in our own stories, I think we can't take for granted that some very detailed virtual reality games will eventually emerge that let you take on the role of a time traveler or alien visiting our past and tinkering with it, so there's obviously a motive to do it. I would add two notes to that. One, probably one of the most profitable inventions in the future will be someone coming up with a way to cloud people's memories of the here and now, or their here and now anyway, while they are in those simulated realities so as to feel fully immersed in them, either believing they really are a time traveler during the experience, or even not remembering their life, awaking in some ancient piece of history with amnesia, or maybe just not caring, like we tend not to think about what's happening while we're dreaming. Of course, there's some absolutely dystopian things you could do with such a technology as well, but that's for another episode. 2. I think we should note that if the mini-worlds multiverse theory is correct, and there are other universes next to ours where each and every what-if can happen, or which break off when you enter them and travel to them as possible, is going to have people taking this action. I often talk about how if this type of travel was possible, we probably would settle unpopulated copies of Earth, where humans never evolved, rather than trying to settle barren planets light years away. However, while I think that's true, I think you would also see a lot of invasions into already settled places with more primitive folks. For some, a world empty of humans to go build in is a nice option, great for moving people to, and basically turning into suburbs or resource mines for your prime reality. But for others, heading to some already populated planet to introduce the primitives to higher technology would be a preferred option. This is not necessarily a blatant attempt to go play God King either. You might feel that going there and showing them labor-saving devices and cures for diseases was a very kind thing to do. Multiverse timelines are very nearly infinite, possibly even infinite, but if you ever ran out of existing civilizations to technologically or culturally uplift, there's all those others where proto-humans dwell waiting for that next evolutionary step, or even popping back to the Cretaceous to save the dinosaurs and help them advance to becoming a civilization. This isn't wiping out some other timeline either, you still have the timeline where you did not show up, or did and stepped on a butterfly, or sneezed on a dinosaur and accidentally wiped them out, or jumped into the asteroid belt to give a little nudge to an asteroid to land on the Yucatan Peninsula at some point. Uplifting options get a lot stranger and honestly are more plausible when we put time traveler, multiverses, or various subverses into play. Subverses, incidentally, are where you make a universe spawn from inside an existing one. This would include, but is not limited to, setting off a new Big Bang via a newly formed black hole, or creating a simulated reality of sufficient sophistication and complexity. It could potentially include alternate timelines, but would depend on the specifics of how that functioned. There are a lot more theoretical options for that than multiverses, which themselves are not limited to alternate timelines. They are one of our background topics and themes for discussion this year. Pyramid builders are probably the biggest camp for discussing ancient astronauts or visitors uplifting humans, but it is not alone. That also tends not to exclusively focus on the pyramids and 3000 BC, and indeed tends to dispute the age of the pyramids to 10,000 years old or more. We also have the Anunnaki hypothesis, which tends to revolve around the Sumerian king list, That's a list of human kings that we found in 1922 in cuneiform on clay, where this or that king is said to have ruled in Kish or Akkad for 300 years or 1200 years or so on. And it has an earlier antediluvian period where folks were reigning for tens of thousands of years each. The Anunnaki are the various pantheons of that region, and the notion is that this king list is the evidence of their existence as extraterrestrials. Specifically, that they are aliens who arrived here 450,000 years ago, genetically modified our ancestors, and used them to mine for gold. They come from the planet Nibiru, which is argued to be in a highly eccentric orbit around our sun and comes by roughly every 3,600 years. You have probably heard Nibiru suggested as a Planet X candidate before, or Nemesis analog, and this general theory tends to get linked up with the Mayan calendar a lot too. Such a planet would need to have a semi-major axis of orbit of 231 AU, 231 times as far from the sun as Earth, and thus be getting as little as 20 millionths the sunlight we get. I imagine the theory does have some explanation for how these aliens survive out there, but since I can't think of several terraforming or paraterraforming techniques that might allow it with fairly plausible technologies, and have also discussed alien biologies that would work in ultra-cold environments, I am not going to fight the theory for that. There also could be a planet out there we haven't detected yet. Certainly when the theory was developed, that was fine. Nowadays our detection is getting good enough that we probably would catch anything Earth-sized even that far out. But if we're hypothesizing alien critters living way out there anyway, we do not need to assume they came from an Earth-sized planet. An icy dwarf probably would work as well, and would be a great place to set up a space colony for any civilization with fusion technologies and interstellar space travel. And before anyone writes me to complain that I'm feeding the theorists good ideas and excuses, yeah, maybe, but I did say I was going to give them all a fair and respectable treatment. As to why they want gold, or why they would come to Earth for it, or why they would engineer proto-humans to be slave labor rather than use robots, or just claim the planet for themselves, I have no idea. The theory may go into details on that, but I don't consider it very plausible, so haven't further deep-dived it. As a side note, mining Earth for gold was also the motivation of the evil aliens from L. Ron Hubbard's Battlefield Earth. The book does give a slightly more detailed justification than the movie for why they need to use humans to help mine, and why the evil aliens don't just claim Earth as a new colony, but merely an isolated mining outpost. Hubbard, the founder of the religion of Scientology, also suggested humans were interfered with by aliens. As I understand it, there is dispute if the popular accounts are what the church actually believes. But I will relay the popular account with that caveat noted. The theory goes that 75 million years ago, an evil tyrant named Xenu, who ruled a local interstellar empire of around 100 worlds, rounded up a bunch of his people, froze them, transported them to Earth, dropped them in volcanoes, and then dropped hydrogen bombs on them. I'm not clear why these additional steps were necessary, as opposed to just shooting the dissenters, but given how often I've said there's no such thing as overkill, I can't really flag that either. And dropping folks into volcanoes and then nuking them does sound appropriately supervillainy for a galactic tyrant. Anyway, their spirits or souls were then trapped on Earth and brainwashed and like to latch onto humans, which causes us spiritual harm. Which isn't exactly uplifting, but presumably could have parallel effects. And we could imagine lots of unintentional uplifting cases where some leftover alien tech gets discovered, or like the monoliths from 2001, A Space Odyssey, flat out uplift those critters who approach it. Though the series is unclear if that is their main role or even a primary one, we did discuss that more in our recent episode Machine Monitors over on Nebula, which was the main immediate inspiration to write today's episode, if you were wondering why we didn't bring 2001 up earlier. Scientology is hardly the only religion to suggest outsider uplifting, though in most it is usually some actual higher being than aliens that did it. Though that distinction can admittedly get a bit blurry or arbitrary in some cases. Raelians also believe human life was created by aliens known as Elohim, who have advanced genetic engineering and who also appeared as gods or teachers to us. This is actually completely fine as a process. It's certainly possible aliens could have created all life on Earth, or modified proto-humans to true sapiens, and walked among us as gods. They also espouse life extension by cloning and mind transfer, which is plausible enough, though probably not a good path, to biological immortality compared to mind uploading to an android, or just repairing an aging body, but that's a different topic we have discussed in other episodes. As with some of the others, it mostly suffers from the big question of why the aliens came and left and aren't around nowadays. As I said, I'm very skeptical, but most of these can't really be outright ruled out as possible, especially with minor tweaks that would match them up better to various emerging technological pathways or cosmological theories, like mind uploading or multiverses. So, not impossible, they just aren't indicated by actual evidence. And we could come up with tons of possible scenarios that would decently tag motive, means, and opportunity, but lack any falsifiable evidence that they are what actually happened. Of course, a lack of evidence doesn't mean something is untrue either. There are tons of past peoples or events of which we have no evidence, and sadly, probably aren't going to get any. That's the whole problem here with quasi-historical or mythological figures. They are the only folks important enough to have been recorded or remembered over all this time. And we just assume they have been given godlike status and didn't have it. And of course, an alien or time traveler or visitor from some higher plane of existence could have shown up with real powers and been remembered too. So we're sort of stuck saying it's possible, but there's no evidence showing humans were uplifted, and pretty decent evidence showing a chain of fossils and evolution, and primitive technological and cultural relics showing a more natural progression. As a quick side note, we probably live in the first century in which virtually every human being is going to leave a permanent record lasting eons, and one bigger and more detailed than virtually every major historical figure who lived more than a few centuries ago, which I think is a pretty neat thing. For me though, and to finish up for today, the biggest thing I have against such theories is non-scientific. It's not that they don't make for good stories, but I feel the real human story is also a noble one, and shows our ancestors, primitive or not, to be smart and motivated and curious. They traveled to every corner of the world long before history was recorded, and did wondrous things wherever they went, even with very little technology to achieve those wonders. I feel it demeans them to assume they had to have outside help or pushes to build those great wonders and civilizations. And I feel we have plenty of examples of us choosing to undertake such great tasks inside firmly recorded history so that we can show we have such a propensity as a species. Moreover, it is that very propensity to envision great tasks and pursue them, to dream big and then work hard to achieve it, that is the source for so much of my optimism for humanity's future here and out among the stars. Perhaps we were uplifted by someone, and we may meet them out among the stars one day. But for my part, I'm more interested in how we can lift ourselves up there, and I think our history shows a story of us dreaming our own big dreams and then putting our minds and backs into making them happen. But what do you think? Let me know in the comments on this episode. So today we talked about ideas for how humans might have been helped along by some other agency, and there's always the question of what happened to them afterward, or what our own fate might be in a distant era, and one option is that we might just keep making our brains bigger and bigger. In this month's Nebula exclusive, Jupiter Brains and Mega Minds, we are going to explore the idea of enormous minds, computerized or not, and just how big they can go, to planet scale and beyond. That's out now on Nebula, where you can see all our episodes early and ad-free, along with exclusive and bonus content from myself and many other creators, like our monthly Nebula exclusive episodes. You can join now for about $2.50 a month, about the price of the drink or snack you've been enjoying during the episode. We also now have lifetime memberships available and gift cards that let you share Nebula with friends and family when you sign up at my link, go.nebula.tv/IsaacArthur, and use my code, IsaacArthur. You not only get access to all the great stuff Nebula offers, like Jupiter Brains and Megaminds, you also be directly supporting this show. And again, for those of you who want to share everything Nebula has to offer with your family and friends, Nebula is now offering gift codes. Use the link gift.nebula.tv/IsaacArthur to give a year of Nebula to a friend for just $30. That will wrap us up for another Sci-Fi Sunday here on SFIA, and next week, August 15th, we'll jump back to the near future to look at what the next technological revolutions might be, covering a couple dozen different technology sectors. After that, we'll be looking at the topic of space warfare in the far future to explore the role and makeup of battle fleets on August 22nd. And speaking of jumping around in time, the week after that, we'll examine the idea of retrocausality and how events could precede their causes under known science and theory. If you'd like to get alerts when those and other episodes come out, make sure to hit the like, subscribe, and notification buttons. You can also help support the show by becoming a member here on YouTube or Patreon, or check out other ways to help at isaacarthur.net. You can also catch all of SFIA's episodes early and ad-free on our streaming service Nebula, along with hours of bonus content like Jupiter Brains and Megaminds, at go.nebula.tv/IsaacArthur. As always, thanks for watching, and have a great week! Thank you.